I'm nearly 100, always remember that.
Sunday the 27th of December, 1925. Wrote the following. They laughed, and Misty faded into the elfland, and a fairy song came floating to that veil beneath. A fairy song that weeping, laughed, and laughing wept. They were gone. And I sighed in the valley, in the lone dark valley of shadows, for the fairy folk at play. Yearning, I thought of the elfland, and the fairy roundelay. The air was filled with a nebulous waving, and voices, as of the falling leaves, or slow, gliding water. I dreamt of forms that came from the violet shadows, cloudy, silvery gleaming, of pale, cold faces, pale with the moon's ray, the fleeting touch of cold, cold hands, of happenings passing strange. I awoke. I was come from the elfland, from a land of voices and shadows. Sighing, uprising, I went from the valley.
Now, Hannah Frank began working as an artist in the 1920s, and she carried on into the beginning of this century when she was in her 90s. Her critically acclaimed sculptures and pictures are still being exhibited around the country. Some are also on show in the Glasgow care home, where she's lived since 2002. Judy Herman went to meet Hannah there in the company of her niece, Fiona Frank. She's editing the diaries her aunt wrote almost daily as a young woman, growing up in the artistic community of interwar Glasgow.
Do the shamus and then the yellow lights. Yellow lights, all the rest. And I'll give you prayer while you're doing it.
Okay.
I will now say Hanukkah, which is a very, very important prayer for every Jewish person in the world.
Just
at
the
real time.
Wednesday the 10th of July 1929. A letter from Sidney Needoff, accompanying the reproductions of my drawings that I had asked him for, thanking me for the poems, which would surely feature in the first issue. I had the spark divine.
In tall tree shade and fairy, and strange wild music played, piercing the ear with sweetest sound, so that I trembled. Dimly lit, a train moved from the forest steps. They were gone. I heard the music still, faintly, wafted faintly, till it died in the forest steps. That's a nice poem, isn't it? I stayed me there. You don't have to see much to start me off in that one.
I know.
I stayed me there in tall tree shade and fairy. F-A-E-R-Y. Most of the poetry I read was in an attic.
Yeah.
During the war, where we lived. We lived in a house with three stories and an attic. What I enjoyed most was sitting in the attic, reading the poetry.
Can you remember about the poems that influenced you?
I read the Bible a lot for the sake of my drawings. Why did I read the Bible? Because it was poetical. I like poetry. I like the poetry parts of the Bible.
There are fabulous verses that come out of the Rubaiyat. If the wine you drink,
was the flesh you press, the wine you drink, end in the nothing, all things end in, yes, 'twere better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all.
Half of it is the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam, translated by Fitzgerald, and half of it isn't. Auntie Hannah put those two together. What were the influences on your artwork?
Well, the books I read, the poetry I read. I was a big reader.
Sunday the 12th of April, 1925. Directly after dinner, I sent Arthur with a six and threepence, collected from various sources, to buy from David a complete Shakespeare that he promised me for that summer. I am now in possession of the complete works of William Shakespeare, bound in red leather with gilt edges. I am extremely proud of it. The Rosenbergs were here to tea, and David, Rita, Solly, Morris, Arthur and I played in the attic, till Solly became a trifle too playful, and I finished reading Pericles, Prince of Tyre. Sunday the 3rd of May, 1925. Apropos of study, Mama and Papa both vehemently condemn my practice of reading indoors. David, who was here yesterday, is of the opinion that I lead a miserable existence. Mama says I will become morbid and melancholy. Monday the 30th of March, 1925. I am again at school, but my timetable has changed. I continue Latin, French, English and history, and instead of mathematics and science, every week I have 13 periods of drawing, which last are exceedingly apt at boring me. Latin is the subject which for me is grown extremely enjoyable and is the period of the day to which I most look forward with pleasure. Miss Agnew reigns supreme in my heart.
Nothing sexual. I had crushes in women as well as in men, and one of them was Miss Agnew. I so wanted to please her, as far as I remember.
Is that why you went to study Latin?
I became good at Latin because of the crush on the lady Latin teacher, that's right. It's all in my diary, actually. And in the private bits, I used the Greek alphabet. That should be of particular interest to you because they were very private, and it never dawned on me that a niece would arise to whom the Greek alphabet was peanuts.
So you're quite happy for me to read the bits that are in Greek, aren't you?
No, I'm quite happy. But at that time, they were private, when I had definite crushes on people.
It's not in Greek, it's Greek letters.
Oh, well. Can you read it?
No, but I'm learning. Miss Agnew reigns supreme in my heart. And then there's lots of pages that you tore out.
Ah, I probably had crushes. The only reason I would tear out pages was I had crushes on unlikely people.
And here's a picture. Hectic preparation of Livy and Virgil. So you wore glasses as a young child. Miss Agnew gave us a test on Virgil vocabulary, during which she remarked that Lizzie was squinting at my paper, which indeed she was.
Thursday the 18th of February, 1926. Latin. This morning at 9 o'clock, Miss Agnew came rushing up to say that the rector wished to interview the boys in the small art room. Then, exclaiming that she was far too early, she went rushing away again. About 5 minutes later, when Elsa, Jeannie and I were at the fire, talking, Miss Agnew returned and joined us at the fire. We had a good little gossip. On her asking me if I were going to university, I replied in the negative, and then of course she remembered. Mr. Crombie had shown her my drawings a few days ago. They were wonderful, perfectly wonderful.
If they would leave the choice to me, I think I know what I would be. To be an artist, my desire. And that was when I was young. When they asked me at school, everybody was asked what they wanted to be. And to be an artist, my desire. I'd paint with gnomes and they would tie it.
You told me that your mother had to go to Bailey Drummond to help you to get into the art school.
We discovered that it might be difficult to get into the art school. There weren't any women at that time. I had to get influence to get into the art school. We had a Bailey next door to us. And my mother said it was the hardest thing she ever did in her life, was to go and ask Bailey to use his influence. So I believe he was very nice about it.
Was that because you were Jewish or because you were a woman that it was difficult to get in?
Probably because I was Jewish. I don't know. I don't want to imagine, but I just don't remember.
How did being Jewish affect your art?
Well, the way Jewish would affect anything. It would make me have slightly more interest in the Jewish, anybody who was Jewish connected with art.
There was Benno Schatz who taught you.
Well, Benno Schatz he took an interest in me. He took an interest in me, I think, rather than me taking an interest in him, because there were no Jewish artists at that. I don't, well, I could be wrong. I mean, I'm just talking out of the top of my head.
But there weren't many Jewish other Jewish artists studying at the School of Art, so at the time.
No, I think I was a one-off.
People used to say that all your women that you drew had a Jewish look about them.
Well, that stands to reason. They were the people that I knew. And that's a compliment. I wouldn't think anything, there was anything remarkable about that. People who draw or paint do the things they're familiar with. I'm not a one-off in that respect.
Wednesday, the 30th of December, 1931. This afternoon up for Eva, and with her to Bell's. Elaine there, and I spent over 3 hours drawing her. There is a profile and a three-quarter view, and, wonderful to relate, everyone concurs in thinking them good likenesses.
Most of the drawings have women in them. Why such a focus on women?
Because I was much better at drawing women than Ben.
Yeah.
That's the only reason. And Ben didn't interest me particularly. Women had a nicer appearance. I didn't have any ideas about men's anatomy or anything like that. Women I quite liked. I was a woman and it wasn't a mystery to me. Women are much more inviting to draw and to sculpt than men. You'd have to be very interested in men if you decided that they were going to be your subject, and I wasn't all that interested.
Monday, the 3rd of June, 1929. To the art school and saw Ivy. We discovered there was no life class, so we betook ourselves to the library and pored over 2 volumes of Aubrey Beardsley. His work is beautiful, but he didn't do himself justice. He expended his genius unworthily.
I got up at the crack of dawn to go to university, which I loved. Going up the hill. There weren't, I think, don't think there were many women there at all.
No, that's right. It was more men, wasn't it, that was studying there?
Tuesday, the 30th of April, 1929. Delighted to find Belle on my car to the university this morning. Delighted to have her companionship up University Avenue and in the quadrangles. I was surprised to see the magazines were out. We both bought one, and found Somnia on the centre page opposite a page of poems by Jacques. In the editorial we found mention of Amoeba, Bombastis is probably the discovery of the year, Popsky, Pam, Congu, JMB, Elaine, Lewis, Sandy, Ochre, Sai, and Alaraf. Of this last was written, to Alaraf we are very thankful indeed for teaching us that serious drawings like hers are acceptable to all the university public. There's no question about their distinction, but it was lately confirmed by an award in the School of Art. Jacques, a Beardsley fan, is wild about them.
Tell me about your name, Al Araf.
Well, I had to think of a name that nobody else used, and Al Araf struck me as being a nice name. Al Araf was a star that appeared in the heavens. In a few nights it grew brighter than Jupiter and Venus, then it disappeared and was never seen again. And I thought that was a nice romantic name.
Absolutely, beautiful name. What kind of Jewish organisations were you part of when you were growing up?
It was a Jewish student society, and I went on a Sunday, I joined in. And in that way, it was partly, I don't know if it was as much Jewish in it as having fun.
Sunday the 17th to Sunday the 31st of July, 1932. This fortnight I spent camping at Weems Bay, under the auspices of the Glasgow Jewish Student Society. In one tent were Ethel B., Florrie Smith, Rita and I. The first week was made memorable for me by the friendship that I formed with Mr. Friedlander. On our cruises, to Arran and to Ettrick Bay, we were together. We went walks together. I went for bread to the village and saw him to his bus at the same time. By the next week, everyone almost had found his partner. Ethel, with Schlossberg from Manchester, and Rita, with Izzy Mandel, for example. A friendship between Dudley Glass and me developed. We discussed sexual relationships, as everyone did at the camp. He kept with me much of the time. We danced together on our open-air dance floor. I achieved the reputation, with Misha Lovish, of being the best dancer in the camp.
There were various organisations, and Hebrew was part of them. That's all I can... That was part of growing up, part of my background.
You went to classes at the Talmud Torah?
Probably because of the Christian, one of the teachers.
Friday the 23rd of November, 1934. Rita away to Edinburgh. A solitary walk round the park. At 10 o'clock called for Belle and was told I was to find her with Rita Levy at the Oneg Shabbat. Whither I went, and was just in time to meet the people coming out. They weren't there. Eddie Levinson accompanied me to Levy's close. True enough, Belle was in Levy's. Mish read my hand. I had wonderful imagination, but I wasn't a creative artist. Cheek. Lionel escorted me home.
Saturday the 1st of December. A phone call from Monty in the evening to see if I could get a menorah.
Belle in for me at 8, and with her and Solly to Schaefer's, 14 St Andrews Drive, for a Hanukkah Neshef of the Zionist section. Just as we arrived, Frida phoned me, but as I could tell her nothing, she phoned again about half an hour later, when Jack Werner was in the middle of playing. There were there Rosa, Ruth, Yeti, the boy Schaefer's, Alex, Jacob, Ellie, Monty, Sarah Newman, Jack Werner, Eddie Levinson, Golden, Gottlieb. And while I was at the phone, Lionel arrived and, seeing me, knocked at the window.
And there's a drawing of you there. I enjoyed the evening. Jack Werner played, Gottlieb sang, and Ruth and Ellie both did sketches. Belle walked home with Eddie, and I went with Solly, Lionel, and Jack Werner. Ruth and Yeti caught up on us, I with Lionel. I made Solly walk round the park. You made him walk round the park so that you could be with Uncle Lionel.
Oh, I see.
This was 6 years before you married him.
Friday, the 28th of September, 1934. Walk with Rita round the park. Lionel appeared. It was a beautiful moonlight night, and we spoke for a long time. Then I walked home with Rita, and on the way back I met Lionel, and he saw me home.
Tuesday the 4th, a welcome letter from the editor of The Gum, Hugh Johnston, asking if the Christmas number might be graced by a representative of my work for which he has the intensest admiration.
That's nice.
Wednesday the 5th, in the evening with Belle to the Simons for tea. We met Eddie and Lionel on the way. We had our cups read. There was LVY in mine.
Oh.
You went on to marry Lionel Levy.
All the memories my father saying when he saw me, I am a noble. You know what a noble is? An ugly creature.
Tell me about the shop.
And they say, my father was very clever. He planked things on the counter, take it or leave it, and turn his back on them. And they always took it. Nothing not nice about him.
What did he think about your art?
I don't know. He never told me.
He was very proud of you.
Well, anybody who knew me was proud of me, because I was a one-off.
What about your mother?
Well, everybody loved my mother because she didn't have a word to say about anybody. She was kind and gentle. She told me she never told anybody how she was. Mm. She always asked how they were.
Your mother used to go off and rent a house in Ayrshire every summer.
Well, it doesn't surprise me.
You and your brothers used to go off on holiday there every year?
Yes, I remember that. I went here also. I can picture it, but I don't remember it. Sand. Pebbles, maybe. Water. Seagulls. I wasn't a swimmer. I might have gone paddling, if anything. I remember in the lounge, the young men trying to kiss me. That was my memory.
Lives of great men all remind us we can make our lives sublime.
And departing, leave behind us footprints in the sands of time. These are my footprints in the sands of time.
And your sculptures. So these ones up here.
That's my favourite.
Yeah? And out of her cold cottage, never answered Mrs. Gill, the fairy mimbling, mambling in the garden.
That was during the war, in our attic. Now, don't let me go down if I don't look respectable.
Okay.
You hear me?
Yeah, have you got anything else to tell us?
Sorry?
Anything else to tell us?
No, you've to tell me.
Okay. You're going to be known as an artist forever.
I hope so. If they would leave the choice to me, I think I know what I would be. To be an artist, my desire. I'd paint with gnomes and ne'er would tire.
It's your birthday party.
Well, it's not my first birthday.
No, it's not. I don't know. They want to come because they like you.
You must have encouraged them.
No? Yeah, a bit.
Where's my stick?
There.
Thank you.
So come.
That's my favourite.
Yeah?
And out of her cold cottage never answered Mrs. Gill, the fairy mumbling, mumbling in the garden.
Lovely, that's a Walter de la Mare poem.
Sorry, no. During the war, I saw the fairy in my imagination, mumbling in the garden.
Yeah?
And out of our cold cottage, never answered as he'd go. The feeling, moving, hungering in the garden.